and the assists per kill for Team Envy were actually a full assist higher than Team Liquid. So yeah, a lot more teamwork there, as reflected in the stats, as well as what you saw in the end of the game.
Exactly. It's my favorite stat for kind of breaking down how a team plays. It was 2.78 assists per kill for Envy, 1.78 assists per kill for Liquid. So it kind of shows you what their kills looked like. They tended to look like team fights. And also, to sing the praises of a player, Seraph went off, of course, on Kassadin, and highest damage in the game, 947.7 damage per minute, extremely high.
Now remember, another reason why the assists per kill are going to be higher for Team Envy is they were losing a bunch of the early game. Mm-hmm. Early game is where solo kills happen and duo kills happen. Team Liquid, they had strength in the early game. They had a bunch of, you know, isolated skirmish victories, and that also contributed to that stat. Meanwhile, though, let's take a look at this. We got pretty much the same bands, actually.
Exact same bands.
Team Liquid on the same side as well, because Team Envy, they did get choice for this pick band phase, and they decided they wanted red side, so they can get that double pick on the counter side. Plus, they also get to hide their last counter for sure. You know, maybe switch up some champions through the different lanes. They're a huge fan of flex picks.
Mm-hmm.
To a fault.
Yeah, and sometimes to their gain as well. I mean, you're right that sometimes it does go wrong. So far, the exact same pick and ban coming through. The run back is here. Echo being hovered, and look at this, more similarities. The same comp so far allowed. Actually, no, some differences, of course. Instead of the Rek'Sai being grabbed up, it's now the Gragas saying, okay, Arch, so can you play Gragas? Yeah. What else can you play?
You had a lot of success there on the Gragas. The thing is, Rek'Sai is even easier to play than Gragas is. So
sure.
I'd say he should be happy to play Rek'Sai. No opportunities for the ultimate to miss, because you can only use it if you click on a tunnel.
It's true. You can ult the wrong place.
I mean, you also get passive attack speed, so I guess you can use it without doing anything.
As long as you hit Control R. Congratulations, using your ultimate properly. Well, we'll see what else changes up. Still the early priority on Braum, which I always like because he's good against Sivir. I think if Sivir's allowed, you should put some priority on that champion because he breaks up Ricochet. But even still, I think Sivir a great champion. We'll see if it comes through. Last time around, Liquid would have rather played Jhin. We're going to change that up and actually go Bard Sivir here.
All right, so they steal away the Sivir from Laude, and they do pair it with another very good assister here. Bard in the bottom lane, going to create some more plays. Matt's Bard was one of the things that got him a huge amount of notoriety in the North American LCS, and one of his most praised champions. We'll see if this is going to be enough to turn it around for them. There definitely are possibilities of cross-map plays with the Bard. Mm-hmm. You're double ranged as far as, you know, the 2v2 lane, trying to play into Braum, try and abuse him early on, make use of the side lane brush to get off a lot of extra harass, whittle him down. Definitely have to respect the kill pressure, though. Lucian Braum, one of the old school kill pressure duo lanes there, especially with Proxen on the Gragas. Proxen's been one of those guys to take some oddball gank routes and gank early and often with that champion.
For sure. It's worth pointing out an interaction that Braum has with Sivir is that even if you spell shield the fourth hit of the Braum passive, it doesn't go on cooldown. He can just re-tag you and stun you right afterwards. So if you're stuck in a scrappy battle, you're going to get stunned at some point by that Braum.
I mean,
so life can be hard. And we actually have the Kassadin coming back through. So Liquid saying, I think we can pick better. Two Kassadins in a row.
Will it be better, though? Let's see here. Phoenix did have a very good individual performance, and we didn't expect anything less from Phoenix, right? As an individual player, has been great for the majority of this LCS split, and also had another good game last time around. This time, though, he'll be in the counter matchup.
Mm-hmm.
The roles have swapped here. Ninja taking the Vlad, and this time Phoenix will get to try his hand at assassinating the back line.
What if we're in a world where it's actually still top cast and an Echo goes mid?
I mean, it could very well be. I don't see the reason to do that
because
they're both, you know, assassin, melee, EP champions, and Lorlo has so much more time on Echo than he does on Kassadin.
Agree completely. I think it makes a lot of sense. Last pick comes through as Irelia for Seraph. Last time around, he played Kassadin as the counter pick. This time, Kassadin taken, of course, off the table. Liquid said, no, you can't. That's going to be our champion. So he moves down the tier list, I guess, to the Irelia here. He hasn't actually played that champion very much in the second half of the split. Used to play a lot of split pushers early on in the season. That's tapered off, but he's now back with the Irelia here in the regional qualifiers, up 1-0, hoping to make it 2.
Question is, will he build it like Ray builds it? Dustblade.
Unlikely.
And go full assassination damage. Definitely unlikely. I think it's very funny here that this pick bans Team Liquid have basically stolen away the strategy that Envy used in the previous game, taking away the core of Kassadin and Sivir. With a little bit of augmentation here with the Bard to be able to set up these plays.
Yeah.
It's really scary. If Bard ult lands, you know there's a Kassadin, Sivir speed boosted dive comp coming at you.
Yeah.
Pretty soon.
One thing that I think is very good for Liquid here, though, as we get ourselves into the second game, is they've picked champions that will just work better in the late game, where if they already assume they're going to be better at ganking, they're going to win their laning phase, they're going to get that 5,000 gold lead at 30 minutes or so. When other champions are suited to actually push that advantage forward and close the game out instead of getting outscaled, and so some of the weaknesses might be covered up by their champ select as we get ourselves into game two, as Liquid hope to make a comeback against Envy, who squeaked out game one.
Meanwhile, Team Envy looking to cement that 3-0 that Lod was proposing in his video.
Yeah, push it forward. It's definitely the hope that Envy can close this out, hide their counter picks, hide the rest of their strategies, and show up tomorrow refreshed and ready to go against Cloud9.
I mean, that would be one of the most epic gauntlet runs.
Yeah.
And this is coming from a region where we had the Cloud9 run where they went all the way.
I was going to ask you, actually, if either Envy or Liquid do make Worlds, is that more or less impressive than the C9 run?
Oof, I mean, the C9 one was really epic. But yeah, with C9 being higher than Envy now in this gauntlet, like C9 and Immortals right now are, it's just kind of assumed that that will be
incredibly
the last game
hard
of the
final
gauntlet,
bosses,
because
yeah,
both of those teams already shown in playoffs that they are, you know, putting in a ton of work right now. And, you know, part of the reason why Envy and Team Liquid are so considered so much underdogs in the gauntlet is not only their finishes, but also, you know, I guess we haven't seen them in a long time, so we haven't seen any improvements, whereas we've seen on screen the improvements that Cloud9 has made from the regular season to the postseason.
Just watch Impact for the last couple of weeks, and you're like, okay, this is going to be hard.
If it was just that one player, everything else, I'd say that, All right, we are going to have Delayed Invade to stop this Gromp, though. Let's see, will they be able to finish it? They're actually staying on in a long time. Stayed on it very long here. They're not respecting. They saw him come in here to try and...
All right, time to earn a little bit of gold. Oh, he's going to get it! Yes, he is! Unlucky. Matt swags away and goes, I don't want to get queued. He might get queued. Ooh, what a great stun, though. Flash auto, okay. Matt's still in danger.
My life for the Gromp!
Exhausts Lod, might have to flash away. Hakuho doesn't have his own flash. Q's not gonna
chase
land.
Chase him down, tilt! Heal, well, flash!
And Envy are gonna miss half a minion wave. They're gonna lose all the health they lost from fighting the Gromp.
So,
and Jinth is quite far ahead.
Jinth got solo experience on the first wave. Plus, Matt's not even behind because he got Gromp experience.
Yep.
Stealing the Gromp.
They're both
This is Sivir with control of the lane. It is Sivir paired with a ranged champion to also try and harass you as she has control of the lane. And Team Envy, almost always when people place a defensive ward and they start the Gromp and they see the enemy come in to try and harass them on Gromp, almost every single time they'll stop and they'll say, oh, you know what, we're not going to take any more damage from this, and they just go to lane, and both teams consent to no jungle starts for themselves. But Team Envy a little bit stubborn there, and they are punished for it as Matt not only steals the Gromp but baits out an extra summoner. Well, I guess he uses exhaust too.
And right now, actually, Archsecond is a camp ahead of Proxen. It's already level 3 when he was doing the blue buff steal. Proxen just getting that level himself. So Archsecond actually in a pretty good spot himself up a camp.
As I said, you know, Rek'Sai is a more simplistic jungler. A lot easier, especially for someone who recently has switched over to jungling. This would definitely be my go-to champ for pro play. A little bit less early playmaking. We'll see if Proxen can make that up. He definitely still has flash. But he's been seen on that deep river ward from Lorlo, so they know his whereabouts and shouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, shouldn't be too much. We'll see what happens, though, as Proxen is roaming around into the mid lane. Phoenix, half HP, level 4, Kassadin already out of potions. But a great ward says, there's someone coming.
And that ward is, I mean, it's kind of expected, right? Because I said they just got seen in the river. They knew he was over there. There's only one place he can go. He just went down from the river. They know he just cleared out that side of the jungle, so... good job there. Phoenix spies him, and he will not be surprised as predicted.
Arsec can waste a little bit of time in the mid lane. Looks like he's going to fight for this Scuttle Crab in the bottom river right now as Ninja pushes the wave in. And Phoenix will likely, he will teleport to get back in and not miss too much here. Right now, plus two minions for Ninja.
Yep, use your teleport to get back to lane. That's how you shore up Cassidy's laning phase. First teleport doesn't provide a whole bunch of kill pressure unless something crazy happens in one of the side lanes where they're just trading super hard very often. I'd say most of the time you definitely want to use it just to get back to lane and try and get through that lane phase. And it's working out well for him. Was able to refill his corruption potion, add the extra ring here, and try and get to that level 6.
And we'll see what happens. Jinth and Matt just shoving up in the bot lane right now. They have managed to actually make this lead quite a bit closer than before. Envy doing a pretty good job in this laning phase of not falling too far behind for how bad the very early game looked. So you don't expect to lose lane being this matchup, and that's the case they're in right now. Jinth up 4, and Matt up the Gromp. Otherwise, a pretty docile game right here. Slight farm lead for Phoenix, good for him. Top lane actually going a bit better for Lolo than it was in the prior matchup. Now that he's facing Irelia instead of the Kassadin, and life looks good.
Look at this. Good guy arc second, brings a pink ward on his first move up to the top side, places it for Lolo so he can keep pushing Seraph in. As of right now, though, Seraph should actually be able to get a lead in CS. Even though he's down right now, there's a large wave at his turret, and Seraph, or Irelia, is one of the best champions at last hitting. Here we go, Phoenix not level 6 though.
Only level 5, has the flash, a great flash followed by Proxen. Do they have the damage? Probably not, actually. His Q shield was good enough, and Proxen did not have to flash because it meant nothing at the end of it all.
Yeah, I mean, he's not level 6 either. Gragas doesn't have ultimate. That would have been perfect play if he did have ultimate and he could get him back into the lane, but Phoenix, he hits level 6 on that minion.
Ninja can heal soon if he doesn't run out of ults. He's gonna wait for it. Oh, this is the timing. He wasn't quite there. Now he can turn back on a mat. No, he doesn't land it. And the snipe from Arc second, his second first blood in 2 games.
Oh my goodness, what Ninja a heartbreaker for Envy. That is really rough. Phoenix had even given up on that too. Phoenix was back to farming, and it was Arc second and Matt that actually closed out that play.
Yep.
First 2 games on the LCS stage, 2 first bloods.
Yep.
This guy is a prodigy.
There we go.
Jungle god.
Who even is Dardock? All I know is Arc second's best jungler Liquid's ever had. Oh, I'm being facetious. Dardock's obviously a very good player, but
ruthless freak.
I'm hyping up the new guy because it's cool.
I as well am.
What's great actually is casting him in the Challenger series. Arc second was really known for playing Xerath and other poke mages. And now you've got a champion who's got a, like 1200 range skill shot.
Small ones.
Yeah, Proxen got some of them. So ArcSec is actually used to sniping people from like halfway across the map in the mid lane. This is like complete comfort zone for ArcSec.
Yeah, forget about all that playing melees back to back and
yeah, no. It's the Q skill shot.
And frontline tanks. Yeah,
that's all that matters.
Yeah.
Nah, it's going to snipe people. AP Rek'Sai coming in.
Regardless, though, he is also doing a very good job controlling the vision. We should talk about, you know, the steps of what would it take if I was a new jungler in the LCS. Well, he's doing just that. Scuttlecraft control. He's got the first line of the vision wards. Moving in with the Raptor smite that he smited away from Proxen. That's why he went for the big one, focusing on the health of it, plus able to get the smite away so you clear out extra vision in that side of the jungle. And, you know, that first line that we talk about is when you just step past the river, but you don't want to step into the second line of brush, because going into the brush inside the enemy jungle, that's where you get turned around, you get killed, you get, you know, completely snowball the enemy's lanes. In there. Well, actually, Phoenix here.
Body slam into Phoenix. His cast had actually ripped off a couple of times, so his mana pool's not great. Is able to slink away, but running out of health, down to half HP as Ninja sustains back up in the mid lane.
Yeah, Phoenix just goes and trades with the jungler there over his dead ward. Very angry about it. Bottom side, Scuttlecraft going over to Proxen, though, as Seraph tries to make quick work of Lorlo. But the passive speed there from Echo is big.
Big? You could say massive. I think it's accurate.
I feel like I just had used it, so I didn't want to use it again. Okay. Anyways, Lorlo going to use the ult back to lane, as has come to be expected of him. Plus, he built the phage first, so that's why the speed was big.
Impressive, you mean?
Lorlo doesn't have ult for this fight, by the way. Remember, he just used it to get back
Seraph
the lane.
Seraph cannot dodge the stun, though, so Lorlo gonna heal back up a little bit more. Gravity and Dying Spend's gonna land, though. Seraph running out of HP, the flash follow, and the second grass comes through. Lorlo, living up to the name of his keystone, takes him out 2-0 with a solo kill.
Oh, man, that is gonna be rough for Seraph. He's probably gonna have to TP back to lane. Another wave is coming up right now. Lorlo pushing that in. Really strong outplay from the solo laner from Team Liquid. Team Liquid once again. Early game going very, very well for them. They got a solo kill with their top laner. Jungler got the first play. Jungler, look at that. Very nice, docile jungler.
Safe blue buff handoff. Red buff doesn't steal it. Arc Second knows the pain. He makes sure he doesn't do it himself.
Just sits there and tanks it. That's
Take
the,
notes.
That's the jungler mentality when you were previously a mid laner.
Yeah.
Yes, I'll sit here and tank this blue buff for you as long as you want. Yes, yes, clear another
wave. Yeah, clear the wave. It's okay.
Yeah, don't worry. I'll be here. I'll be here. I'll hold it for you.
He's going to be okay with that one. It is actually going for... It's interesting. I've seen a couple of junglers do this, but it's the early Jarm's Fist Rek'Sai. Oftentimes, we see the Tiamat Rush. Sometimes, we see this one.
It's been rising in popularity quite significantly, Jarm's Fist, just as a standalone item for the stacking potential, because health is such a good early game stat. Early on, your scaling of just your champion per level, armor and magic resistance, is pretty high, and you want to. Your first defensive buy should almost always be health. Obviously, it does depend on champion specific, generally
primarily.
That is the rule. Your first item is health, and that's the way that you get the most out
durability.
Of your defensive. Yeah, durability out of your first defensive buy. Phoenix here going for a pretty good trade. Does get his Thunderlord's proc and Proxen waiting to punish him next time he does go for it.
Okay, there's the Riftwalk in, but Phoenix has basically a million mana at his disposal. The solo. Drake take actually got a little bit of help from his team. It looks like they're running over, but Arcsecond has himself an Ocean Drake for the rest of Liquid. Now Hakako's got to run away a little bit, puts up the shield, jumps back to Lod as they retreat. Snipes don't mean too much, dodge the stun, and they're going to be okay. On the hunt now, on cooldown, Jynth gets nothing for it.
Regardless, though, look at the massive vision control. Team Liquid, this is the most surprising thing to me. Yeah, they have had success in the early game and they've been getting a lot of these kills, but look, they're putting a lot of time and effort into controlling the jungle. And I have to say, Arcsecond, you know, you get smiley faces or gold stars. Across the early game here.
Right now there are 5 wards past the river that Liquid own right now. That is very, very good for any stage of the game, let alone before 12 minutes right here. So a lot of vision to track Proxen as the early game's looking great.
And well, look at what that's doing for Team Liquid. As okay, we have a aggression in the bottom lane and there is no Sivir ult, so they have to take the culling and take a bit of harass. However, some hot cocoa lying in the bushes and potions being chugged by both.
Does the body good. Seraph once again trading up with Lorlo that wants to take this fight. He knows the W's on cooldown right now and gets a very nice chunk down. Lorlo at half.
Oh, moving here from Arcsecond with the teleport as well. Akko's pretty low.
The TP attempt, what can they get for themselves? Lorlo at half HP, looks for the stun, get a lot of damage on a Lod, and there comes the reset from the Bard ultimate. Lod's not gonna go anywhere with this one. There's the kill picked up. Jynth makes it the third of the game for Liquid as they sit 2,000 gold up right now. Phoenix. Can help them kill a ward, and this turret could go down.
Yeah, the other great thing about these deep wards that Team Liquid are putting in, you can teleport on them. Yes, I can scout the enemy jungler. I can counter the plays you're trying to set in motion. Plus, my top laner, who's getting solo kills and controlling top lane, also gets to come down. They get the turrets gold. Yes, first turret's gold there for Team Liquid, in addition to the lead in kills that they have. And even though that does cost Lorlo a pretty decent amount of CS, honestly, it definitely worth it. You get that first turret bonus, and your bottom lane has complete control.
And they made sure they donated it all over to Jynth, 650 to him personally as we watch this dive again.
All right, so Hakko is obviously going to be the target, flashes away that Umbro, very good job, but Lorlo just on the edge was going to get the stun, not going to happen, so Matt covers it up. Bard ultimate just on top of it. Good slight overlapping there of the two zoning spells, and they are able to find it. Meanwhile, Phoenix has been just blasting Ninja in the mid lane in this matchup.
Oh, man.
The junglers have been scouted so heavily that it was pretty easy for Kassadin to trade really aggressively in that matchup and make a...
Lorlo. Yeah, ults back for the heal, gets some damage on Proxen, who flashes away. Doesn't quite get stunned, but it's going to be enough anyway. Lorlo gets the kill on Proxen, and now it's poor Seraph underneath the turret. Jynth has aggro. He's going to get hit up. One more hit will do it. He's going to get the kill picked off. Jynth pulled aggro, screwed it up, and went down. Still a double kill for Lolo, not the worst in the world. 5-1, top lane turret under fire.
I mean, Lolo was pretty low also, and he had already used his ultimate, so there was no, like, super
ideal tank.
Exactly. Meanwhile, though, let's take a look at the bottom lane.
Flash chase. Phoenix almost gets lobbed. One more hit. He'll do it, but the knockout comes through, and they're going to turn it around. The retreat comes in. Arcsec gets his second snipe of the game. Both kills with the Prey Seeker.
Teleport there, or Ninja actually just ghosting to walk down there as fast as he could, but he's too late. Nothing for them to clean up but minions. And man, the counter kill actually was pretty good for Envy. This game is definitely slipping away from them, just like the first one.
Yeah.
The thing is, you don't want to let that huge gold disadvantage build up, because this time around, Team Liquid, as you pointed out in Champ Select, they are the ones with the server. They are the ones with the Kassadin. You know, they're going to be running you down over those neutral objectives. Vlad, though, takes a lot of damage while trying to take down the turret. This counter kill is pretty impressive, though. He sticks around, relying on Hakuo, his stun. The potion being chugged right there is what keeps him alive long enough to get those autos off. And then Hakuo had the good knockups there. Prey Seeker, though, finds another victim.
He's going to land the Q and a Jin. He's already spell shielded as well. Not going to get the stun thanks to Hakuo's shield itself. Ooh. As the flash chase comes in, two-man tempered fate from Matt, and going to get away from the explosive cask as well. So a safe retreat by Liquid. Yes, they break some stuns. The last shot comes through. Seraph with the max range transcendent blade from downtown picks up the kill. I'm trading it back a little bit, but it's still a 3,000 gold deficit for Envy. They've got to make a lot of ground up right now. Looking at the mid lane for their first turret, maybe, but Phoenix has so much damage. Clears the wave, nothing to be done.
Oh man, that was actually very surprising that Lorlo was going to go down there. He does. Oh, Phoenix actually loses his blue buff off the back of that as well. Good thing for Team Liquid, though, their top turret not going to go down because the minion wave was pushed up, and Seraph cannot stick around to finish it off.
So a tight game for sure. Bot lane going back and forth in kills and farm. There was a moment where Lod had the lead. That traded back around thanks to the double kill down there and the turret and everything else. Liquid looks good. Infernal Drake spawning in just 40 seconds right now. And TL with the lead, 2,500 gold up. Likely to be the ones in control for that. The Ocean Drake helping a lot as well. Early Ocean Drakes are just absolutely insane for making your laning phase look good. And infinite mana, a nice benefit of that.
I feel like this is the best Drake curve, Ocean into Infernal. Here we go, though. This is that top fight. Lorlo even had the red buff. He's fighting in the cannon minion wave. A lot of minion damage, actually, there. I'd be very curious to look at that recap, because he's tanking two waves worth, and he actually went right back into that stun. Seraph's like, okay, I'm happy to fight you with my two sets of ranged minions plus cannon and just stun you up. Lorlo doesn't realize till too late. Ah! Gonna lose this 1v9?
Yeah, 1v9, if you count them minions. We had discussions earlier about minion rights, and if they count as full, you know, full champions.
They definitely don't count as full. So maybe if you have three waves.
All right. That's like each wave is a champion. It's like a 1v2.
Here we go, though. There's the Infernal Drake. Seraph going to teleport in an end fight.
A bit of a team fight. Matt taking a lot of damage. One more hit will do it. They're going to knock him down. Seraph gets one already. And now Jinth in a whole world of trouble. And a bunch of kills now coming through. How much more can they get? It's a double already for Seraph. He's got flash available. Liquid running away. The nice Q from Hakuho after the flash. Lorlo's going to jump over the wall.
He also has his ultimate, so I don't know if that flash was really advised, but Team Envy are going to try and get a turret off of this. Minion wave control is
really
the objective
small, though.
Here.
It's not going to be enough. The tank goes watch out. Ninja could get stunned. He might have to pull, and he will do so. Hakuho quite injured. Is there much more of a chase for Liquid? Phoenix, wants to go in full health bar. Lorlo gets stunned up, and oh no! That was way more than he wanted to bite off right there. The second time Lorlo dies for phase diving in.
I don't think they were communicating that, because it looked like Lorlo was just playing off of Phoenix's actions rather than pre-planning that re-engage. Kassadin had already turned around, just going for some poke there, and Lorlo went for the kill. But let's take a look at the first kill. Matt was CC down as he got culling. Good little dodge there by Lod as well to get out of the parallel convergence. And now we're all over the place.
And that, I believe, was a 3-for-1 long form right now. The Drake's still alive, so someone else could pick that up in the near future, but the gold has been chopped back down to an only 800 difference. And once again, Liquid get a ridiculously good early game, and then a team fight happens, and Envy bring it back to equal.
Pretty much. Lod here is going to curve out a little bit quicker than the Sivir as well. See if he can stay afoot. He is in a more self-sufficient AD carry as well.
I do think, though, to hit the point again that we had before, is even though Envy are playing the mid game better, I do think the scaling still does lie with Liquid, that this is not the same as game one where, oh, Envy tied it up, they're going to win this one late. I think it still does rest on Liquid's hands.
Definitely a possibility. There are tools that Envy have that can be used really effectively. As you said, Braum Wall, that's always great against the Sivir. You can try and destroy the Ricochet. And then Lucian is a much more, as I said, self-sufficient AD carry than Jhin, say, from the last one. Mm-hmm. So a little bit less susceptible to Kassadin. We'll see how well Laude can play it and how well his frontline can also play it, because it is very much a team effort. Yeah. Try and defend team fights against Kassadin.
For sure. We are actually seeing a more assassin-focused build from Seraph. He's going Yomu's Ghostblade second. Mm-hmm. Maybe it is going to be Dusk third after all. Normally we see things like Ruin King in that kind of build. Not going to be the case here.
Gotta say, I love what Rey has done to the top lane itemization builds.
Duskblade and everyone.
Duskblades, full damages. All right, here we go, though. Infernal Drake number one. Because the last time they started off, we were unable to finish. This time around, success for Team Liquid. They claim Drake number two for themselves. And even though the gold lead has disappeared, the Drakes remain, and they still have those bonuses.
And we'll see how much more they can get, because Liquid are playing pretty fast right now. No one is here to really stop the bot lane. There's a bit of a flank coming in. Braum to the left-hand side. Liquid gonna have to disengage this one. Big heal flank. Dive for Ninja. W's in and has to retreat, though. He's gonna catch a bit of a heal. 800 health back in for this one.
Huge hemo plague, but there's no damage to put on top of the damage amp there. Yeah. Team Liquid are able to kite right back out. They trade ultimates. That was the Sivir ultimate blown to kite it back out. And we'll see what they get when they stick around here.
Attempted blue buff. Looks like it went over to Proxen on Envy, though he's wearing a blue himself. Good smite, good barrel. Out they go. Liquid definitely are not wearing blue buffs, so I believe he did go to him.
Big difference here as well. Casted and build. This time, Phoenix is not opting for the Lich Bane split push damage that Seraph went for. He's going right into that team fight of the Zhonyas. That team fight playmaking that we talked about for Kassadin allows him so much offensive power when you can go in with the confidence that you can also stasis and wait for the rest of your team to swarm in with the speed from Sivir ultimate. So maybe Team Liquid look to push up that timeline where they can try and start taking those victories. Meanwhile, Envy though, Siege is back on.
And there we go. Bot lane outer turret goes down. Nice split pushing by Seraph. Mid lane under fire. Gonna stay alive for now, but Envy now up 1,000 gold. This is really good. They're actually doing very well on this one, making the comeback happen so far. Lorlo doesn't quite get the haste from Seraph. Gonna look for one more attempt. Can't get it.
Yeah, Kassadin was trailing him. One of the strategies that I've really been a big fan of for the past year, kind of, is the change where in teams where you have two split pushers and in teams where you have double teleports, you can have one trail. One of the more common split pushers, right? One of the tank ones, more less threatening. Mm-hmm. More or less threatening. That
yes.
was good.
good job.
But and then you have them surprised, right? When the enemy thinks they can take your sort of less threatening split pusher and they try and jump on them. And
surprise, Kassadin.
Kassadin's there in the background. And he's very good at chasing people down. So Kassadin's one of the ideal champions for that strategy.
Yeah, definitely. I want to talk about some more of the sort of synergies here, because I see Kassadin so little nowadays. I kind of want to talk about the interactions we have here. I think both Braum and Aurelia are very good into Kassadin. I think it's part of the reason he's going Zhonyas. Like, Alistar has to, like, consciously pulverize a target, right? And if Kassadin's zipping around, he's got to save the cooldown. Braum just auto-attacks you once, and as a melee champion, you will get stunned.
He's got to consciously auto-attack him, too,
I mean, okay,
right?
Sure, but
hope that all these guys are conscious while...
I achingly turn off my monitor when I play League of Legends. This is why I'm losing LP rapidly every week, but... Hakuho has a very easy job, a relatively easy job of actually CCing Phoenix and making his life very difficult in 5-on-5s. Just takes an auto attack, 1 second cooldown, no big deal, and just more tools that Phoenix has to somehow navigate around when you have to land auto attacks to do your full combo, and Hakuho has to auto attack to kill you.
Assassins definitely don't like crowd control.
True. And we saw actually...
Here it is again, the trailing split pusher play. Can he make it happen this time around, though?
Seraph running for dear life, doing the best he can. Jumped on by Lola yet again. Grasp triggers, the slows are there, and Phoenix now going to be in range. Flashes for everything else, and... Oh, Seraph is just going to run out of HP in this one. Flashing over the wall, Lorlo still in the chase. One more phase dive could do it. Gets the Q, Time Warner's going to set it up. There's the shutdown. Nicely done, Liquid, with the trailing Kassadin in play. Gets the 2-on-1 kill.
Now they can shove up the bottom lane. They're actually going to have Phoenix just recall. They did use both their solo lane flashes in order to get that kill, but they didn't use any teleports. So they can still respond. If Envy try and collapse on this mid lane push, there are two teleports waiting to be used. They don't try and bait him in. They don't really. The minions were all dead, and there's no ward, so that's the only reason, really. Yes, you have your teleports, but if there's nothing to use them on, can't really bait that one out.
So gold going back Liquid's way now. First team to hit 40,000 gold here as bot lane tier 2 goes down. Nice split pushing by Lorlo. You saw a little bit ago, Jinth very afraid of Envy's potential fight and kind of burned his ultimate a bit prematurely. So no On the Hunt available for a little while. It will be back up well in time for the next Drake. That shouldn't be too big of an issue as the 45-second timer is all that Liquid needs. Blue Trinket, Croxen should probably get this smite. Yeah.
Probably.
Nicely done, he gets it.
There is a stage in the game where you really start respecting mage burst and mid laners, and that's why we always talk about, oh yeah, you need a zone for Baron smites and stuff like that. Not quite there with the Rod of Ages and zone, yes, can't quite out damage the smite yet.
Mm-hmm. Arc second going to Tenek Hydra as well, so more damage coming out of the Rek'Sai, and now Phoenix. Uh-oh, finds three enemy champions there. Ooh, dodge the body slam with a flash knockup. It's going to be everything they need. I don't see him getting out of this one. One more hit will do it. Lot gets himself the kill. 2-1 and 2 for this Lucian. Time the game back up. Envy still striking back.
Yeah, he will come up in time for the Infernal Drake. So for Team Liquid, yeah, that always sucks when you give up a kill like that. But, you know, they do have a Sivir they can try and rotate over for wave clear. And
but will he be in time? This Drake's going to lose a lot of health. Sivir's not there. Arcsecond doing what he can, but he has to respect some of the damage output and be just a little bit gun-shy because they're actually playing the split push game. Seraph is in the mid lane, just soloing that mid lane turret down. Going to knock it out, and Envy tying the score up again. And look, there's a knockback out of Lorlo. He's going to ult back in, but a couple more attacks will do it. No, Tempered Fate hits him. Will this be the re-engage for Liquid? Damage on a Seraph, quick shield block for Hakuho, and they're going to be okay.
But if they can whittle him down, you know, chunk out the health bars in preparation for this Drake, that also is a very big deal. Now it's only 10 seconds away for the Infernal. Envy healing back up in the river, and they have a teleport on Seraph. Seraph is going to purchase, then come back out onto the field.
And meanwhile, the Ocean Drake Liquid got earlier is helping them stay topped off for this move forward. They're all nice and healthy. Right now, playing mid lane priority is Liquid as the Infernal Drake spawns just now. And Envy say, do we rush Drake? Do we defend mid? And they're going to waddle over towards the mid lane, but this is a bad choke point. This could be cut off. You can see Matt
there
looking
is a
for the
ward.
Stun.
Look at that ward now. Seraph's going on it.
Here comes the Seraph flank. Look into the back line for Phoenix as Liquid runs away, but it's a bit of a disjointed retreat. Seraph's got to run back into the slow into arc second. Watch out for the stun as Lorlo looks for a little bit, and looks like Seraph's TP means basically nothing.
Definitely a bit disjointed, as you say. Pretty hard to collapse on that, though. I mean, the team lane spot is very mobile. Uh-oh. They're actually going to try and start up Inferno while defending mid.
It's a difficult call. I mean, Liquid clearly have priority. They can get the chip damage down on the turret. Envy don't want to let it go. They don't want to trade objectives. They want to fight for this one. Here comes the dive in. Ninja wants Jinth. Explosive cast doesn't do a whole lot, but it does mean Sivir gets dropped out. 1-0 so far. Ninja catches the heal. They're now onto Matt, and Bard goes down. The third kill as well on the backside. Arc second drops his life. Now a gold lead for Envy. It's a 5-2, and they're going for Baron.
Yeah, they can upgrade their neutral objective now. No longer focusing on Dragon. Here comes Lorlo, though. Misses the stun.
Missing the stun. 600 health going back into Ninja's pockets thanks to his empowered Q. And Envy make the right call to go for the fight. It was tricky, but they made the call. Knock it from Hakuho to try to buy time because they're saying, focus, Baron. Focus, Baron. Knock it down. 1,000 health left. Smite is up for Proxen, and he's going to pick it up cleanly. Nicely done. Envy now sizably ahead.
Good job by all members there. Nice zoning from Hakuho. Able to get the knock up on both solo laners. Doesn't go down. They don't lose anyone in this fight. And they get the Baron afterwards. Jin. It spends the entire time just running here. Ninja drive-by kill onto the Sivir, circles around. That was almost all Ninja right there. Just runs through the entire team. Vladimir drive-by, and Jinth did not get more than a couple autos off. Maybe only one the entire time.
And he, you know, is going for the standard offensive build. I can't fault him for going you know, into the items he's going for here, but he just got worn down so rapidly here.
That's why Ghost is so popular on Vladimir. You know, there is the option, as we saw last game, to take Teleport as well and have that extra global, but Ninja making good use on the team fighting there. Able to get huge neutral objectives for the team. Baron and Infernal over to Envy. And once again, we have a game, early game going over Team Liquid. Couple of solo plays, some jungle first blood, Envy takes over in the mid game. more coordination here. And actually, they do not have teleport on Seraph, so Envy has to run for it.
Sivir ulti pop, Liquid pulling the trigger, trying to make the play happen. Lolo's on the flank, lands a two-man stun. Here's a Naga from Arc second. This is the fight that Liquid needs, but do they deserve it? It's a two-man temperate fake to make the play happen. Ninja in the front lines, but he's pretty tanky on the Vladimir. Dives forward, puts on the pool. Lolo running out of health, and now Arc second gonna get stunned up. This is now a dead Rek'Sai. No, she's gonna just barely slink away, but here come the reinforcements. Seraph is on. He's here to make some arrests. Looking for the kill. Ooh, on to Matt they go. Phoenix in the back lines as well. Trading blows back and forth. A very spread out fight as Hakuo's out of HP, but it doesn't matter. Two kills picked up, and now Phoenix on the wrong side of town. He's not going to get revived for this one. This is going to be Proxen.
Dancing around. God, no, help.
Well, he's
nope.
waiting for his team. He can't Nobody, win going under
his
Phoenix.
His team's not coming. You can wait as long as you want, but Hakuo has only got 100 HP.
No one's around to help him. He's just buying time because the rest of the team running around near the mid lane, near the bottom jungle, and a strange encounter all said and done.
Trying to trap a Kassadin.
Good luck with that. He's got full mana, and an Ocean Drake's actually giving him some health back. There's the body slam flash, and Proxen gets the officially solo kill.
Patient there,
yes.
Proxen.
Wow.
Toys with his prey for a little while, corners him against his own base. Meanwhile, though, the reason he had to do that and the reason he had to wait, Laud and Seraph as well were pushing up, and they're trying to get that global gold, make use of the Baron buff.
All right, nicely done. And here we go. A 6,000 gold lead puts Envy in the driver's seat. And once again, they have done such a better job of winning the team fights. Now into bot lane tier 2, the macro play, honestly, just on point for Envy as they grow the lead even bigger.
Eerily similar to game number one here, and
yeah.
The map has gone dark for Team Liquid. All right, let's look at this, because this is one of the cases where it was almost Team Envy. Eyes getting a little big here and chasing too many kills at once. They realized, though, that they were starting to lose a couple of the battles. Hakuo got super low. You know, they almost didn't have enough people to send off and chase down all the kills, but then they regroup. They collapse on the stragglers and are able to pick up some more advantages for themselves. Only one outer turret still stands for Team Liquid, and Envy have actually grown this into a very sizable gold lead.
Yeah. 6,500 right now. We'll see if it gets any bigger. Chances are it will. They've been the better team in the late game. Absolutely. Ninja playing the wave clear, no big deal. Mid lane under control entirely. And at this point, you just kind of watch from Envy's perspective and say, what's next for these guys? What's the next objective for them? Because anything they want, they tend to be able to take.
I say go back to the split push. You know, they're sending Seraph. He's got the teleport. He's got two levels on Lorlo and Phoenix. So
oh, man.
I don't care who you send at this Aurelia. There's nobody that can answer it by themselves. I'm not even quite sure if they can kill him in another one of those trailing solo split pusher plays where they both go. Maybe. It would definitely take them a long time because Seraph also has flash. So very easy for Envy just to go back to the split push, send this massive Aurelia to create some pressure, and the four-man squad siege up, try and take down the extra gold here.
Well, here comes the potential for a play. Phoenix gets a bit of damage, kites back out, and of course, thankfully for Liquid, they've got that Sivir. So the wave clear is there. They can buy a lot of time. Here comes the next wave. Laud can knock the wave down pretty quickly. There's the boomerang blade, and he hoped that he could see Jhin get baited by the wave. Not going to happen just yet. They're going to go for it here. And here comes the play. Seraph, 1v2, looks for the play, gets stunned up, though by parallel convergence. Plenty of damage into Phoenix, who has to cut away, pops the Zhonya's, and Seraph just saying, yep, you're mine. Nope, not going to get it just yet. Stuns Lorlo instead. Body slam chains in, and suddenly life is bad for Ekko. Ult's back, but he's going into the enemy team, and there's the kill picked up. Envy doing a great job turning it back around. Seraph just does not take enough damage.
Yeah, that's the reason I was skeptical about that 2v1. Yep. Seraph is going to capitalize. Envy are going to take the inhibitor turret, and they've broken their way into the Team Liquid base.
Nicely done, making it much faster than last time around. It took many fewer comeback team fights. Envy making it look a lot better here. 33 minutes in, middle inhibitor is dead. Envy are poised to make it a 2-0 lead in this best of five.
Looking to actually deliver on that 3-0 promise, even though opening up in game one and even game two looked a little questionable, but man, have they been able to take over in the mid and late game. And honestly, that was the story for Team Envy for most of the split, right? The big successes were always in that mid game. Seraph not only is he the captain of the team, but he does a lot in, you know, directing them towards the late game, split pushing and focusing on these objectives. And they have had very, very good control.
Yeah, gotta say, just overall, massive props to Envy for how they are navigating these mid games, because they're getting down substantial counts. There was like 3,000 at 15 minutes. That's pretty big, and they still made it happen.
Yeah, there is definitely some for both sides, because Team Liquid are making some unforced errors and, you know, opening opportunities, but Envy are capitalizing on them very well and getting those punishes to work.
We'll see what next punish is. As we move forward, Seraph once again splitting in the bot side. You've got Gragas dealing with minions and monsters in the top as they once again find their lane assignments. Looks like 3-1-1 this time around. Vladimir holding the mid. Ninja can easily run to either side, whichever one is needed, as the primary force is going to be in that top lane. Baron is going to be alive. So is the Mountain Drake, actually. So some neutral objectives also to play for. They don't need to go for turrets. Instead, they play the vision game around neutral objectives, and they will start the Baron right away. There's some wards around, but it'll still be very difficult for Liquid to make this even happen. So they're going to recall 10,000 health on Baron Nashor. Ninja spotted up, takes a bit of damage, but he's Vladimir, doesn't care too much. Hakko holding the front line. Here comes the teleport.
Envy want this fight.
And they're going to catch Matt, though. It's going to be one picked off already. Lod's unstoppable. Here comes the dive on in. Phoenix got to run away. Seraph in the back line. He's already picked off Jin. Phoenix going to run for this one. Arc's second running out of health as well. Jumps over the wall, but here comes Seraph anyway. And it's another one. A double kill for Lod. A 3-0. Envy can do no wrong in these fights. Liquid just limping and losing more and more limbs every time.
Envy gonna run it straight through to the Nexus too. They're looking to end the game, not delaying at all.
Not at all. They've already
Well, maybe a little bit to try and kill Phoenix.
Maybe.
Stare him down.
Fantasy points don't exist here in the late game or in the postseason, so it's gonna be the Nexus towards the primary target. What matters is winning the game and winning the match. And so far, 2-0 in games. Envy have started their run. One last fight to seal the deal. Push Phoenix away from the Nexus because they will grab the last kill. Lod is godlike. The Nexus goes down. And Envy are one game away from their rematch with Cloud9.
Team Liquid definitely with some issues to clean up towards the mid game. Losing Dardok, that's why people said it was such a big deal, because losing Dardok, not only is he a great individual jungler, right? This guy, he's got great mechanics. People are saying, oh, you know, he arguably could be the best person on their team just as an individual player.
Sure.
But he did so much as far as giving the team a direction in the game, right? In-game shot calling is one thing. In-game leadership is another thing on top of it. And, you know, even if, you know, some of the words he uses are harsh sometimes, or
sure,
they create strife within the team. Team Liquid, without Dardok previously in the season, looked like they struggled to find that direction, right?
Yeah.
And that is kind of surfacing here.
Yeah, the direction they've got right now has been downward. They're fine in the ganks. And again, I'll repeat what I said from the first game. Arc Second, as an individual contributor, seems fine. He's getting the ganks off. Two first bloods in a row. That's a great track record. The early game leads continue to be here for Liquid. But as you said, the leadership, the direction isn't there. And Envy doing such a better job of team fighting.
As far as 2 week old junglers that I've seen, Arc Second is the best.
I got to agree with that one, but unfortunately, Liquid's still not the team that they expect to be with this current lineup. So Envy, hey, good job to them. They're leading this series 2-0. So let's hand it back to the analyst desk.
Thank you, gentlemen. Another victory here for Envy. 2-0 out to the lead here in this best of five. But once again, we see that early lead established by Team Liquid. So, I mean, this kind of points to two things. One, Envy's still struggling for whatever reason in the standard lanes, in the early portions of the game. And then on the flip side, Team Liquid not able to turn those large gold advantages into victories through team play.
So the story of it basically is Envy's early game is quite bad. They're not really finding any opportunities for any ganks, for any actual pressure themselves. Liquid is moving all across the map, making those early advantages. But unfortunately, it just looks like Envy has a much better idea of how to play League. Like, they're winning the fights out. For example, we saw Lorlo solo out Seraph, right? He's doing really well, but then randomly decides to throw away the lane, dueling him in the creep wave of two creep waves, and then you just throw that out. Or committing five people for a dive on Bata where you only needed like three. So Envy just kind of waits out and says, we're going to team fight you when we're strong, and they just win every time.
Yeah, it's really interesting watching Envy, because I know that their team fighting is quite good, but they are a good mid-late game team, and they always have played to that strength.
Right.
And their laning phase has just been the thing they sacrifice. So teams that can beat them in the laning phase and continue transition will always crush them pretty quickly.
Well, that's what happened in their series against Cloud9. That Cloud9 kind of was surprised by how well Envy was able to execute one of their compositions in the team fighting, yeah. and they were unable to handle
that. Cannon? Yeah.
Yeah, the Cannon Lissandra, the double Zhonya's, you know, pseudo tanks.
And how about these draft adjustments, right? So we see Team Liquid deciding to take away the cast, and given that both teams decided to stick with bans, we were questioning whether or not we were going to get the salty run yeah. back, but Team Liquid make the adjustment. They take the Kassadin away, but now they're picking it into, you know, the late game Vladimir damage, and then also giving Seraph a very solid split push option.
It's just not the Liquid champion, honestly. Yeah. This playing with Kassadin requires so much knowledge of playing the macro game. You got to understand waves, how to flank properly. It's a very much, you cannot be in the front line. You have to understand the windows in which you weave in and out, and we didn't see any of that. The split pushing wasn't really there. We saw him maybe one time holding against Braum Lucian.
Where's the Cassiopeia here?
Yeah.
Where's the Phoenix Cassiopeia, right? If we're talking about a Team Liquid
yeah,
champion, Zyrene, that would be the one
Cassiopeia
I would jump at.
Cassiopeia would be amazing.
With having seen Vladimir picked in, I would feel that would be not only give him some pressure in the lane, allow them to maybe, you know, even more so win those early games and then turn that into higher DPS output late game.
It's got to be a denied
yeah.
pick.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They're thinking they don't want to send Kassadin again into the Echo. We don't want that matchup. So.
Right. It's just entirely a counter pick or a pick away.
Yeah, but Seraph had no problem playing the Aurelia into the Echo. He did the highest damage on his team, second highest damage in the game behind Phoenix.
Yep.
And that's another thing that's jumping out to me is Envy are always running triple threat compositions with their top laner being somebody who's a big threat. And Lorlo is just getting solo killed in lane a few times during the mid game. He's giving up these leads.
Well, we even saw him take grass without dying. So when you talk about being a threat, right, just he's opting for a slightly less damage output build in his mastery choice.
Well, I mean, we have to remember that Team Liquid has played all this time with Darduk being their main carry. It's a jungler carry team. And while you have a new AD carry as well, the kind of backbone of the team is the support, the top laner and the mid laner. They're not used to playing without a huge damage threat from the jungle.
Yeah, so that's a huge, huge adjustment.
You don't know what kind of plays you have to make, how much damage, how much more peel and safety you have to offer in the team fight.
Let's go into some replays here. 17 minutes in will be the first kind of big trade for Envy. 2-for-1 near the Drake here. They will push into the mid and pick up a third kill later, but won't be in the replay.
Yeah, Hakuo has actually been playing incredibly well on this Braum all day. I loved his previous team fight last game, but this one as well. Great Braum ultimate across multiple people, buys them the time, gets knocked on key targets, and gives them enough time for that TP to come through without the disengage coming out.
Well, and that's where I think we return to your point about Envy just understanding how to play League a little bit better. One, they were very decisive in their choice to fight there, but two, in their target selection, right? Zeroing out the Bard and then seeing the exposed AD carry, Seraph knows exactly what his job is on that Aurelia. As long as I get that AD carry out of the fight, this is winnable for us.
And they don't have to worry about peeling for your AD carry, which is one thing that Team Liquid has been lacking, whereas Envy, you just run the Braum, and Braum is kind of self-sustaining with the AD. Just stick next to him, he's going to be able to stun everybody around him, and it's a lot easier to play it that way. Whereas what Team Liquid should be trying to do is just, okay, you engage with four, and then you split push with Kassadin. Kassadin comes in from the side, and then eliminates the backline, but we never saw that one time. We see them grouped up as five, trying to make something happen in the death ball. When you're playing against Vladimir and Lucian in the death ball, it's not going to go well.
Now, that fight brought the gold gap closer together, but it's once again around the Baron where we see Envy make their real big stab back into the game. This is going to come 26 minutes into the game here. 3-for-0 in the mid lane over to the Baron.
And this is great. Ninja starts it off. Jhin is so far forward that the Vladimir is on to the AD carry immediately and kills him while he has four members on him. And then all of them chase. Ninja still gets away, and Matt goes down as well. And this just ends up being a very quick fight. And I think a large part of that is the Sivir's like, I need to follow my team. Jhin needs to help out. And he ended up just getting caught because he's way too far forward.
Now, here's those damage graphs you were talking about just there, the Aurelia. You know, second highest damage of the game against that Kassadin, but you can just kind of see the difference in those split push options, and that's where those 1v1s in the later game were happening. There was no answer to Seraph in that pressure.
Yeah, and you know, the macro gets kind of thrown a little bit out the window where the games turn into a, hey, we have pressure, we're just going to push, and you try to come fight us for it. Honestly, this looks like an Envy 3-0. Mm-hmm. I don't think that any advantage that Team Liquid is able to get is going to be able to transition into a win, but that's what they're here for. They want to practice. It's very obvious that they want to just get some games in with these new guys.
Let's look at that Game 3 then, Zyrene, because Team Liquid has opted to swap to the red side for Game 3, so at least something is changing as we enter that third game. But Now you're in the position, let's say, as coach of this team. How are you going to set Team Liquid up from that red side to have a successful game here?
Yeah, it's got to be, of course, counter picks. Like, if red side, you pick it because you want to counter pick. I want to see how their bans change up, too.
Yeah.
Because you might have to leave something open here. Because if Envy are like, oh, we don't really want to ban Gnar anymore, they can pick it up themselves. So that's what's going to jump out to me. But I think the coach needs to be able to recenter Team Liquid, say, you know what, we're getting all of these early game leads. You guys are clearly a better laning team. Mm-hmm. And transitioning that, you just make sure you have clear calls, make sure everybody's on the same page, because we've seen flanks that haven't worked out. We've seen that they have kind of the right idea. It's just the timing is different between
the
members.
I think they just need a bit more wave clear, honestly. They're kind of losing a lot of pressure. They're always being later in the pushes around middle because of the lack of champions that way. Mm-hmm. Kassadin, not one of them. You have
Had Sivir at both times.
They had Jhin, right? So they had Jhin, yeah. Vlad one time, and the other time it's Kassadin with Sivir. While Sivir is good enough, having the mid laner to help that out in the beginning of the early game is a lot better because they're not able to do anything around middle with regarding pressure.
All right, well, we're looking for some kind of adjustments. Maybe the counter picks will be enough for Team Liquid. We're heading into a 3.5-minute break. Join us on the other side to see if Envy can complete the sweep or if Team Liquid strikes back. We'll be right back.